the keynote presentation or plenary presentations of this conference. And I would like to introduce a colleague from ETH Zurich. He's in the same institute as I am, Matthias Troyo, a computational physicist and well known for many, many contributions in quantum many-body theory, condensed matter physics, and quantum computing. And so he's been courted by a number of companies and organizations to work for them on this question of quantum computing. And currently is on a two-year leave of absence from ETH and is working, as you can see, for Microsoft Research. And he's going to talk about high-performance quantum computing. So I'm looking forward, Matthias.
Thank you, Thomas. Yes, so last November in the New York Times, one could read that Holmdahl, who in the past made the Xbox hardware and the HoloLens, now helps Microsoft build a computer straight out of science fiction, a new type of your quantum computer, and for that, four groups joined. That's me and my colleagues from Denmark, the Netherlands, and from Sydney. The immediate reaction from Brussels was, why does a US company purchase European scientists? We have to say that purchase is the wrong word, it's called acquire. And it's the other way around, namely we acquired the funding source for a project that we could not fund with academic money in Europe. But Microsoft's interests go back no longer. The Station Q is then a quantum computing effort that was started by Fields Medalist Michael Friedman more than a decade ago. And there we work not only on the quantum bits and quantum gates like most groups, we work also on the fabrication for it. In my group, the simulation of the materials and the devices. So that's where we use the classical HPC machine. And then on top of that, we build the classical control electronics. That's much more work than just the qubit. Then the operating system running at low temperatures, 4 Kelvin or colder. The control logic, the compilers for the quantum code and classical code, the libraries, the algorithms, and again, I work also on the applications to close the loop. So we work on the full stack. I work on most except the middle layers here. So now, why do we want to build a quantum computer? That's best summarized by a statement that I heard from Paul Messiner a few years ago, when at the workshop he mentioned on the panel on beyond the exascale machines, that he wants to think about something that is not just 10 to the 21 flops, but something radically groundbreakingly new that lets one do things that are just impossible with current technology, and quantum computing might be one thing. We already have quantum random number generators made in Switzerland. There's your quantum communication systems, quantum sensors, there are analog quantum simulators, there are quantum optimizers that I'll come to later, but we want to aim for something that can compute much faster and better than any classical machine can. And that would be the future quantum computer. How does it work? For that, let me start with a quantum random number generator, which already shows the basics. We have a photon source. We have a semi-transparent mirror. The light shines onto that, and half of the light goes through, and half is reflected. And then we want to check which of those detectors triggers. And now we shine in just very little light, so that there's a single photon going there. And according to the laws of quantum mechanics, the photon then follows both of these paths simultaneously. And the location is undecided, so it's in a superposition of both states until I measure. And when I measure, then one detector clicks, and which one is totally random. So that way already we can do something that is impossible in classical physics, namely we can create a random bit. That's being sold in Switzerland, that's great, but that's not computing. So we now want to use that for computing, and so we say let's take this as a quantum bit. So while a classical bit can be zero or one, so it could take the left path or the right one, the photon here, if I view it as a quantum bit, is taking both paths, so it's in a superposition of being zero and one. Can view that as a state on a sphere. The north pole is the classical zero, the south pole is the classical one. The classical bit can only be zero or one. The quantum bit can point anywhere on the sphere. For example, to the right, that would be a superposition of zero plus one with equal weights. But it can point anywhere with any complex amplitudes here. Now, this is a quantum bit. Who of you has seen a quantum bit? It's just so strange, this physics, that Schrödinger said, hey, there's something really strange going on. And he came up with the famous and well-known Schrödinger's cat paradoxon, where he assumes that let us assume that nature is really described by quantum mechanics. And here he has an atom that is decaying, but it is decaying quantum mechanically. So it's not zero, and then at some point it's one, but it goes over into a superposition of being decayed or not decayed. And the machine then is built in such a way that if the atom decays, it triggers a hammer, the hammer hits a bottle with poison gas, the gas escapes and the cat dies. But now if we describe it quantum mechanically, then this atom is in a superposition of being decayed and not decayed. So the hammer is in a superposition of being up and down simultaneously. The bottle is broken or not broken simultaneously, and the cat is in a superposition of being dead and alive. Now you have not seen a Schrödinger cat yet, but what we want to do is we want to build a Schrödinger cat type supercomputer, so even bigger and more complex. So we want to build then a supercomputer that works on these principles. Now, I want to first mention a few more things before we come to the application. And the first is, when we look at the photon, it was either in the left or in the right detector. When I look at the cat, it is either dead or alive. So what happens is I compute, and then at some point I look at my bit, and looking at my bit, I don't get a superposition of zero and one, but I get either zero or one. And what I get is random, and it depends on the amplitudes here. So I always only get zero or one. The cat is always either dead or alive. And that way we can already build our first quantum device. We build something that creates a superposition and measures it, and we have the first application with a single quantum bit. We can do something classically impossible. But let's now go to two quantum bits. With two quantum bits, one can do more, namely one can entangle two quantum bits, and that's really important for computation later on. When entangle two quantum bits, then I can say, okay, I start with a single bit that I put into a superposition, is zero or one at the same time, and then I take two quantum bits, here they are, And then I can put them into a superposition of either both being zero or both being one. So that is both zero or both one. Then I can keep one here and toss one to Thomas. Watch out, don't look at it yet. And then I go back to Redmond, he goes to CSCS. And then at some point later, we look at it. And when we look at it, then what happens? If I measure my quantum bit, I get some random result. It is either zero or one. And when Thomas looks at it, he gets another random result. It's just totally random. However, because those two qubits were entangled initially to be either both zero or both one, he gets the same result as I. Which one it is random, so it cannot be used for messaging. But after that, we both have the same random number, and that can be used for encryption. So now we can build up a random key that way. Why that's important or interesting is that this way we can establish a shared secret that can be made provably secure. And it's provably secure because there's the no cloning theorem of quantum mechanics. If I take this qubit, then nobody can actually make a clone of it. You can't copy it. No eavesdropper can intercept it. Or in case they do, they look at it and destroy the state. And that's what we would find. So the no cloning theorem means a classical state can be cloned, a quantum state cannot be. I can try to build a cloner that copies a zero into two zeros, a one into two ones, but if I apply that to the superposition, it gives me a superposition of the copies and not a clone of the superposition. It just does not work out. You cannot build a cloner. So this is bad news for programmers. You cannot copy your variables. You can't clone them, that's hard. So you always have to recompute it from scratch or think very smartly on how to reuse results when you can't copy. But it's excellent news for secrecy, cryptography, and privacy. But it already shows you the first limitations of quantum computing. But now before that, how do we do? Okay, so we have this secret. I gave one to Thomas. I have one. We use it. We have a random sequence of bits when we send out 20, 30, 100 such qubits that we share. Now we have this random thing, and this is also a device that you can buy in Switzerland and in Japan and elsewhere. And no eavesdropper can listen without being detected, except there's the quantum hacker Vadim Makarov in Waterloo. He specializes in hacking quantum encryption systems. And he has so far managed to break every commercial quantum encryption system on the market. How he manages it, he just uses classical side information, classical loopholes. He then helps the people to fix the flaws to make it secure. What the Chinese do to make it more secure, they place repeaters in satellites, because it's very hard to eavesdrop on satellites. But we want to use it for computing. So let me now continue. See, where do we stand with quantum hardware? And that is very well described by Dilbert, that it exists in a simultaneous state of being successful and not even started yet. But to be serious, yes, we have qubits. The record is 20 quantum bits in the 50th ion traps in Innsbruck, Austria. That's also a technology used by a startup in Maryland, IonQ. The Intel works with spins in quantum dots. IBM and Google work with superconductors. Some people work with the diamond defects. At Microsoft, we want to build a topological quantum bit. And what that is, it's something that the New York Times said that's a science fiction idea. But this audience may appreciate it. What we need to do is we need to make this Schrödinger cat a really stable one. And if you encode information, let's say, in a spin in a quantum dot, whatever looks at the spin, any magnetic field that couples to it can determine the state. So we need to encode the information in some way that when you look at it locally, you cannot tell what the state is. And what we want to do for that is we take the spin orbital in which one electron can sit. So it can either be one electron or not an electron. And now we split it apart in space. So we split this electron or not an electron into two non-abelian anions. They are called, these are two new types of quasi-particles that you can separate in space. So you take this orbital and you separate it in space. In each side, there sits a particle. And those two particles, those two anions combined, when you bring them together, they form either an electron or not an electron. But when they are apart, when you look at only one of those particles, you cannot tell what state they're in, because you need to take this Majorana particle and combine it with the other one. So you have to take these two halves of the electron or not electron and merge them. And as you bring them together, you will see that either there's nothing there or there's an electron there. So that's what we started building. We see these modes and we hope to have a qubit soon that shows that this works. And this should then be much more stable because we place them here on these wires. And when I look at one end here, one end there, I see one particle or the other, I don't know what the state is. I have to bring them together to find out. But while they are apart, I can compute with them. So I have the Schrödinger cat state here. And this should be much more scalable than the other technologies. So how far do we have to go before this becomes interesting? The easier question is, how big a quantum computer can I simulate? For one quantum bit, I need two complex numbers, because it can be in two states, up or down, 0, 1. When I have two quantum bits, it's four states. When I have n quantum bits, I have 2 to the n states. And the system can be in a superposition of all of those states. So that's 2 to the n numbers. So with 2 to the n complex numbers, I can store the state of an n qubit system. And with 2 to the n classical operations, I can do the quantum gate operation. It's nothing but a sparse matrix vector multiplication. So when I have 10 qubits, the memory is 16 kilobyte, and my watch can simulate that. When I have 20 qubits, like the ion traps in Innsbruck, is 16 megabytes. That might take my smartphone to calculate. 30 qubits, I may need my laptop. 40 qubits, I need a big cluster. 50 qubits, I need somebody to give me a 16 petabyte machine. Who volunteers for that? Let's say that might be possible. 60 qubits we may be able to do on an exascale machine. 70 qubit, once somebody gives me a zettascale machine, I don't know whether we're going to build that and have that memory. So maybe that's the limit where it becomes hard to simulate. But definitely, when we go to 250 qubits, then the memory I need is more than the number of subatomic particles in the visible universe. So here, there's no way that I can build a classical machine that can simulate that. Where do we stand now? My students managed to simulate 45 qubits because they managed to get a half a petabyte on the Cori 2 machine, and that's the world record. Google is thus now trying to build a 49 qubit machine, but because that cannot be simulated classically. But my students already said if they use the file system of Cori 2 as swap space, then they can do it. So that's the competition at the moment. So then let's say we have this machine with the 50, 60, 70 qubits that we cannot simulate anymore classically. How do we use it as a computer? That's very easy. We just apply gates to it. And in classical computing, when we program, let's say, Bitstein, what we all do is we put down NAND gates on the bits effectively. In quantum computing, it's not the NAND gates, but you need three different gates. You need one gate that is the Hadamard gate that takes a classical bit, let's say 0 or 1, and turns it into a quantum superposition of 0 plus 1 or of 0 minus 1. Then there's a phase gate that applies a phase rotation to one of the states. And then we need at least one gate that acts on two quantum bits, and that's the controlled NOT gate that flips the second qubit if the first is set to 1. So basically calculates the XOR of the two inputs. Note that all of these gates are reversible gates, because quantum mechanics is reversible, every operation is reversible. That means every program we write has to be a reversible program. That's one of the challenges. Then how do we program it? Just like we don't write our classical codes currently by writing down NAND gates acting on bits, but in a high-level language. So similarly, the quantum codes in the end will not be these gate operations you see in papers and books, but it will just look like code. Microsoft, the programmer, uses this F-sharp. It could be F-sharp code. It could be Fortran code, whatever. It mixes classical instructions with special quantum instructions. So this is just some extra register and extra functional units, and will have some the operations that act on these quantum bits and registers. So the programming language will be whatever language you want, and as I said, it could even be called Fortran. And then that is compiled into code that runs then on the quantum wires that moves our the anions around, and that then does the computation in the quantum hardware. My students wrote the version in Python that couples to the IBM cloud machine and to the ETH ion trap machine. And here's the record from one of the calculations we did that just shows that the code runs. You don't see any magic here, it's just some Python notebook that you execute. But it runs in the background on the quantum hardware. So how can we think about what this quantum computer can do? As I mentioned, the quantum bit can be in a superposition of 0 or 1, so we can be in both values at once. When you have a register of n bits, there are 2 to the n values, but now I can start with this quantum register in some classical state like all zeros, and then act on it with my quantum operations to prepare a quantum superposition of all my interesting possible inputs. I can have up to 2 to the n different inputs values in that one register. So it's like a SIMD register that is exponentially long with a single register. And then I can compute on this. I can compute with all the possible input values. Then at the end, I do a reduction, and I read out the value. And I'm done, and I've calculated something with exponentially many inputs. So the advantage here is this is an extreme SIMD machine with an exponentially long vector. When I have 64 qubits, it's 2 to the 64 is my vector length. But it can be much bigger. The challenges in programming it is that it is a SIMD machine. So it's just pure SIMD. But also, it's based on quantum mechanics, which is reversible. So you have to write your programs using reversible logic and without being able to copy your variables. And readout is limited. But the main challenge is we only have a small set of reduction operations. So the big challenge in finding quantum algorithm is finding something where we know reduction operations that are useful. Let me show something that is impossible classically and where theorists are totally excited about it. Namely, you're given a function that maps one bit to one bit, and you want to check whether the function is constant or not. Now, classically, that's very easy to compute. You calculate the function of 0 and the function of 1, and you just compare whether they are the same or not. But it needs 2 function calls. On a quantum computer, you will be able to do the same thing with a single function call. The way we do that is we have the inputs, we call the function as a quantum circuit that computes here the function of x, xored with one of the inputs. And if you have this quantum version of the classical code, and any classical code can be translated in to reversible code, and that can be mapped to the quantum black box here. So when you do that, then when we act on it with a single input, we get that, but if we let it act on a superposition of inputs, then we get out a superposition of the function values. And there you see that with one function call, I can compute the function for all possible inputs. But now comes the challenge. What happens if I read out the result? When I read it out, I get one of the values picked at random, so I get a random answer. So I randomly choose x to be 0 or 1, and if x is measured to be 0, then because it's entangled with the y register, I get f of 0. And if I measure x to be 1, I get f of 1. Okay, so I get a single answer. And I could just as well have done that starting my whole program with a single random input. So what we have to do is we should not measure, but what we have to do is we have to do a smart reduction afterwards and then measure just the output. In this case of Deutsch's algorithm, the answer is I apply one more gate to here, and then this first qubit turns into the XOR of the two function values that I measure, and I've won. This is where quantum information theorists are totally excited. They can solve that with a single function call. As an HPC person in the past, I don't care about this problem, whether it's one or two calls. It's not that important, and I don't really know the application of this yet. Where's the application where I can only call a function once, but I need to know whether it was constant or not. So we want to look at real applications. And one of the first ones was Shor's algorithm for factoring. If I give you the number 15, then you can tell me easily there's 3 times 5. But if I give you that number, where is it? And I ask you, what are the factors? Then you'll have a hard time coming up with these two prime numbers. How did I do that? You might guess I could have a quantum computer already, but no, I cheated. I took two prime numbers and I multiplied them. And because that is easy and that is hard, that is the basis of cryptography. And it relies on the fact that factoring this number is hard. But a quantum computer can factor this number in polynomial time. And I want to quickly show you now how it does that to give you more of the feeling of how a quantum machine may help in the future with HPC. The naive approach is, okay, it should be trivial because after all I told you, I can run a program with all possible inputs at once. So the easiest is, I just try out all possible factors. I put a register x into a superposition of all possible factors, and then I calculate, for example, for 21, I calculate 21 modulo x. And I get a superposition of all of the remainders. Great. But that doesn't give me the answer yet, so now I have to check an answer. What I could do is I could find where the result is zero. But such an operation doesn't exist on a quantum computer. So we're out of luck. What I can try is I could just measure the result. When I measure it, I get some random factor. And I could just try random factors classically. I've gained nothing. So that doesn't help me. I can calculate the remainder in parallel, but I don't have the reduction that gives me the one where it's zero. So one needs a smarter idea. And that's why it's so hard to invent a quantum algorithm, that the reductions are so limited. What Peter Shor came up with is he knew that factoring can be mapped to period finding of a function. If I look at the function a to the x modulo n, and you can tell me the period, which in the worst case needs n trials of f1, f2, f3, and a check until it repeats. But if you can do that efficiently, then from the period, I can find a factor. Because if the period is even, then half of the sequence, the value, plus or minus one, is one of the factors of n. So how can I do that on a quantum computer? Can prepare all possible values x. I'm calculating, for example, 2 to the x modulo n. 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, then goes to 11, 1, 2, 4, and so on. And looking at that, when I go through it, then I find the period is 6. When the period is 6, now 2 to the 3 plus or minus 1 should be a multiple of a factor. 2 to the 3 is 8, so 8 plus minus 1, so 9 or 7 should be a factor. In this case, 7 is a factor, and 9 is a multiple of a factor. So I have 1. So getting the period of that function gives you the factors. But getting the period is hard classically. How do I do it on a quantum computer? I can get this quantum register in a superposition of all these values, just with one evaluation of the function. But now what do? I don't want to read it out, I just want to measure, because when I measure, it might tell you the function value of 4 is 16. That does not tell me anything about the period. Because it gives just one random value. So Peter Shor's idea was to think a bit smarter. And he said, okay, let's not measure all, let us measure only the function value. Now I get a random function value, for example, 2. It could have been 4, it could have been 1 or 7, whatever. In this case, I got 2. Now the output register is 2. But the input register, which was entangled with it, is now a superposition of all those arguments whose function value is 2. So it's in a superposition of 1, 7, 13, and so forth. Have I gained something? Not yet, because if I measure, I might just get 7, and I don't know what it is. But what I can do now is I can do a Fourier transform. And if I do a Fourier transform on it, that tells me just the frequency and its multiples. So now it turns into a superposition of 0, 6, 12, 18, and so on. So when I do the Fourier transform and then measure, then I get a multiple of the period. I do it a second time, I get a second multiple of the period, and from that I find the period calculating the GCD. So this shows that we can do amazing things that are exponentially faster than what I can do classically. But it needs smart thinking, because while I have this exponentially powerful SIMD unit, the reductions are extremely limited, and the readout only gives me one entry. So what can one do with it? As I said, we can do factoring, but factoring could break RSA. Is that an application that interests Microsoft? No. The reason is that this is not a big market of Microsoft size. Because as we get close to building such a machine, people will change the encryption to systems that are not vulnerable to quantum attacks. And then in 10 years down the road, only those people will want a quantum machine who have old data stored that they want to decrypt. There are a few agencies, I think, that want that, but that's not a big enough market. So we want better applications. We now want to think about what can we do with a quantum machine that's really worthwhile? In that competition, I should not compare what can I do on my quantum machine a bit better than my laptop, but it has to be much better than anything I can do on the best exascale machine we may build in 10 years. So that's the competition. So what are these important applications that we can solve on a quantum computer? Knowing all of the powers of it, but also the limitations in the reductions and readout. But not on the best classical hardware that I may build. If somebody gives me $1 billion to build a quantum computer, then I should compare to what could I do with $1 billion or Swiss francs if I then built a special purpose classical machine for that. That's the competition, and that's what many companies, and not just us, ask. So the approach taken by D-Wave Systems is don't look where you know that a quantum machine can help, but look at the hardest possible problems where you might have the biggest impact. And so they built a quantum machine to solve optimization problems that made it to the Time magazine, where it's written that this promises to solve some of humanity's most complex problems, and nobody knows how it actually works. Well, that's not right, because if they sell a machine, then we can test it. And so we looked at it, we tested it. This machine is a quantum optimizer. It's an analog device, which means it's cheap and fast to build, but it will not scale well. But it's an analog quantum device to solve a quadratic binary optimization problem. That's really interesting because these problems are NP-hard. It can be built with imperfect qubits, and with these bad qubits, they managed to scale it to 2,000 qubits. That was quite hard to engineer. So they built that, and the machine works, and it looks like it's using quantum effects. However, for these problems, nobody knows if a quantum machine actually has an advantage over a classical one. It was conjectured that it might have. When we tested it and measured it, we found out that we don't see any scaling advantage over a classical machine. Compared to the fastest codes we can write, it's about as fast as a single Xeon CPU. And we understand in the meantime why that architecture will not give you a scaling advantage. So we think it's better to look for problems where we know an advantage. So here's some data from them. Here I show the ratio of the time on a PC versus the machine by D-Wave as a function of problem size. For the medium hard problems, it's about constant, so it's the same scaling. For the harder problems, the time of the classical machine decreases as a function of problem size relative to that. We call that a quantum slowdown. So they don't have an advantage. We understand now, as I said, why that is. So we need something better. What one can do is one can look at a list of about 50 algorithms for math problems for which there is provable speedup. So where we know that if I implement that, it can be up to exponentially faster than the best known classical algorithm. So let's start from one of those. And starting from those, which is where most people worked on, we then have to build up the application. Because we want to have a speed up for a real application, and not just a proof of some algorithm that calls some black box function is better than a classical one. For this, we need not just the quantum information theorists, but also a big stack of quantum software engineers who help us build up the algorithm to a real applications. And I want to now show you why it's really important that we start with it now. And this is a really big neglected co-design problem. One example is we know there's an exponential speed up for solving linear systems of equations. If I have a linear system of equations, then I can solve that in logarithmic time with logarithmic memory, so exponentially better than a classical machine, as long as I have an efficient algorithm to basically implement the matrix vector multiplication. So if this is a matrix whose action can be described by an algorithm that's efficient, like a finite difference stencil or something like that, and where I don't have to read in the data, then it can be exponentially faster. If I need to read in all the matrix elements, then at that point I've lost because I need n squared time to read in the data. But if there's an algorithmic description of the matrix, then I can do it with exponentially less resources than classically. And people have looked at that for a wave scattering problem, for calculating the radar cross-section of some airplane. And that was then implemented. And yes, there's a provable exponential speed-up. But when they implemented that for a matrix size of about 300 million, which is big, but not too huge, then they found it needs a parallel circuit depth of 10 to the 29 operations. So even if you code it in parallel, it needs 10 to the 29 cycles. Cycle time is a microsecond. We may be able to push it to a tenth of that or nanosecond, but even at a nanosecond gate time, that would be 10 to the 20 seconds, or about a few trillion years. To solve a problem that is big, but not impossible for a classical machine. What this shows is that we really need to work on the software. We have this exponential advantage, but the constant is off at the moment by about the factor of 10 to the 15 or so. We have to really improve it. That's one thing we want to work on. But first, let's look at something that is harder. Because maybe the problem with linear systems is that they are too easy classically. And we saw this morning that the biggest fraction of problems at the CCS machines, and I took a picture of your slide here, is chemistry, materials, and physics. So if about three quarters of the time is used for physics simulations, basically, or quantum simulations here, chemistry and materials, and much of that is quantum as well, then maybe that's an application. Because this seems to be a hard problem that really needs HPC machines. And Feynman already in the 80s, when faced with the problem of simulating physics, said, okay, it's really hard simulating quantum systems. However, if we had a quantum mechanical computer, it should be really easy. So he proposed that to solve the problem of simulating quantum systems in chemistry, materials, science, physics, and so on, we should use a computer built on quantum mechanics. So that way, these problems become easy. So that seems to be kind of the native application. Use these quantum bits to simulate a quantum system. And indeed, it can be done efficiently. When I take a chemistry problem, I write down the second-year quantized Hamiltonian of how the electrons hop around between the orbitals and interact. This is a polynomial number of terms. I can implement them with efficient quantum circuits. In the end, I can declare victory because it's polynomial. It's only an n to the 9 algorithm. An information theorist is excited it's polynomial. If I ask this audience whether they want to implement an algorithm that scales as n to the 9, I think most of you would run away screaming, and I prefer an exponential algorithm to that. Because for any reasonable size n, this is worse than exponential. But still, it's polynomial, so maybe for small n, it can let us do things that we cannot do classically. So we looked at the small system, the pheridoxin. We used something with 118 spin orbitals and wanted to solve for the ground state wave function exactly to chemical accuracy. And we took the best published algorithm, parallelized it, and estimated it would take about 300 years of runtime on the fastest machine we can imagine. That point, this now seems much more feasible than the trillions of years for the linear systems. And because also for classical codes, we managed to improve them by big factors, we tried the same here. So we sat down and over 2 years improved the algorithms at a high level, at the low level. We reused the computations. We improved the approximations. We improved the circuits. We improved the algorithms. And then we did something that's well known classically. Because here we have a few terms in the forces that are large, and many terms that are tiny. When I propagate the state, I can do the tiny terms with a much bigger time step than the large terms. And that saved a lot. And so we got, in the end, an improvement of a factor of about 1,000 n squared. And with that, suddenly the estimated runtimes came down to minutes. And now it's become feasible. And with that, there's been interest by the companies now, by Microsoft, Google, Intel, that's what started the big gold rush now in quantum computing, that we showed that you can really solve hard problems. One example we looked at recently with the group of Markus Dreierherger at the ETH is we looked at nitrogen fixation. That's the problem of turning nitrogen into ammonia for making the fertilizer. And that at the moment needs up to 5% of the world's natural gas every year. But it needs high temperatures, high pressures. But we know there are bacteria in the root system of plants that can do it at room temperature without using natural gas, without using much energy. And how this enzyme works is not known classically, but if we had about 200 quantum bits, we could solve this problem, understand it, and that might give us ideas for making a better catalyst for a classical manufacturing. So we picked that as one of the example problems and checked, can this problem be solved by a quantum computer? One looks at the enzyme, it's huge. I do most of the calculations classically, and I focus just on the active center, which contains 7 iron atoms, 1 molybdenum atom, and in the middle there's a mystery atom that's known only since about 5 years that it's a carbon atom. So the structure is now known, but we cannot calculate its energy accurately enough with the best known classical methods. But in a quantum machine, we could do it. So now we can use the quantum machine for a quantum full CI calculation of the active core, doing basically a full configuration interaction on a system that's much bigger than we could do classically, and use that in a big hybrid classical quantum calculation. So we still need a big classical supercomputer to do it. And then we looked at the cost of that. Now we see it's doable, and now we really want to know what is the real cost, which size of machine do I need to build, and what does it have to look like? And here we need a classical machine interfacing to the quantum machine. And the quantum machine has a classical control computer. What I need on this main quantum processor, I need about 109 quantum bits to solve that problem. That does not sound like much. But then, those quantum bits that I can build are not perfect. The ones being built by IBM and Google have an error rate of, if they get them down really well working, really great, they aim for about 10 to the minus 3 error rate. If you have this, you need to add extra redundancy for quantum error correction. And while in a classical code you can just copy information, this is quantum mechanics, and I told you I cannot copy information. So it's much harder to achieve redundancy. And basically, to implement these 109 qubits redundantly that they survive the calculation, they need 17,000 qubits to encode one logical one. So it's an overhead of a factor of 17,000. They would need about 2 million quantum bits on that chip to store that. Well, if with a topological qubit where we separate information in space, we get better rates, then we may need only 100,000 or maybe only 40,000 qubits to do it, which seems much more feasible. So looking at those lists, that's why we say we need much better qubits to start with before we start to scale up. Then we need more, we need rotations that apply certain angles to it. And those rotations, I need about 26 rotation factories if I do the code in parallel. Then depending on how good my quantum bits are, each of them needs between 10,000 and 500,000 in qubits. And then these are fed by these phase gates that I mentioned. And these phase gates have to be produced. And there I need, depending on how good my quantum bits are, I need millions to billions of qubits in those extra functional units. So to solve this interesting chemistry problem, it is doable with a machine. The logical qubit number does not sound bad with 109, but depending on how good the qubits are that I need between either millions to billions of quantum bits. Now, we can build classical machines with billions of transistors. So it's not impossible to achieve that, but I'm much happier aiming for a machine that only needs 5,000,000 qubits in total, rather than working with a technology that needs 5,000,000,000. And that's why we work on better quantum bits. The other challenge is that with these number, that with this error rate, you would need a post-exascale classical machine to just decode the errors you get. So here nobody knows how to do the decoding yet. For better qubits that we aim for, we know exactly how to do it. So that motivates why we look for these better quantum bits first. Well, IBM already has 16 qubits. We don't have one yet, but we know we need better ones. So we want really good qubits. So we have at least one application factoring that will vanish in time. We have second year one in chemistry and material science, but there's much, much more. There's, for example, blind quantum computing and blind search. Google does not like that because this is a way of doing search without the search provider being able to find out what you searched for. It can be, with blind quantum computing, you can run on your enemy's cloud service and they cannot find out what you've calculated. That's possible in principle. The cloud providers cannot know what the user does on the machine. This may be great. We don't know what the cost of that is. That's what we have to find out. One can also make quantum money. That's counterfeit proof. There's more, but I think we can also do quantum games and maybe quantum social networks, quantum Facebook. I think the real market will be if I take my qubit and I want to have my qubit entangled with my friend's qubits. That could be, in the end, the market. So to wrap up, quantum computers will come. We have the first prototypes. There are some applications that we know about that are useful, some that we know about that are less useful. There's big potential in using them for the machine learning. We still have to find out what is the best use there, but that would be the much bigger market even. They require us to think very differently than for classical machines. And in the end, this is a really big up the co-design problem. Because this hardware is expensive, will be hard to build. We already now have to think about how do we need to build it for the algorithms we want to run, and what should they look like to work well on quantum hardware. And this is the only co-design problem I know that goes from material science through the full stack, compilers, languages, and all up to applications. So it's a great project to work on. Thank you.
Thank you, Matthias, very much for this beautiful talk. I'm sure there are questions. We have time for a few, I guess, because we're the last session, so we can push the boundaries of the conference.
So, Matthias, thank you for the very nice talk. You've shown your Majorana qubit. Yep. What's the dimension of the device right now? I mean, are we talking nanometers, micrometers?
The length is about 10 microns of the whole wire. The so width is about half a micron. The width is about the quarter micron. The length about 10 microns. We don't want to shrink it because we want to keep the information separate in space. So we want to make that as long as possible. So we don't want to reduce the feature size in the future, if that's your question.
So if you have a micron pitch, then you have a quantum computer of 1 meter if you have a million?
No, because it's about a micron wide and 10 micron long, but now when I have a million of these qubits, then it's 1,000 times there, so then it's a millimeter.
That's reasonable.
So we think of wafers, so we can put a billion or more on a wafer. So that's not a problem. It is a problem for the qubits by IBM and Google, because for 10 qubits, they need about a square millimeter. These are about 100,000 times bigger. They can put maybe a million on a wafer, but not more. But they would need about a billion, so they might need 1,000 wafers.
Good.
Next question. So there's one over there.
So the question is, you commented with the PSOR-SHOR algorithm that you have to compute the quantum Fourier transform.
Yes.
So how difficult is it to compute this transformation, this Fourier transform?
Quantum Fourier transform can be done very efficiently. It's basically a similar trick as you would do for an FFT. So it takes only log n time to compute it. So what you have to do in a Fourier transform, you have to calculate the exponential of I kx. And now you simply go through all of the bits of k, and each one gives you a certain angle by which you have to rotate. So you go through it in a binary representation, and each bit tells you if that bit is set to 1, then I multiply, then I rotate it by that angle. So that can be done quite efficiently.
Okay. Do I see one more question? Otherwise, I have one. You said the co-design.
Yeah.
Going from the atoms, the materials all the way through the software stack. But I hope this you don't do application by application.
We don't want to do that application by application, and that's exactly why we want to identify four or five applications right away to then do it for all those that we know.
Okay.
But for these problems, as long as we don't have many applications, it may actually be worthwhile building one specific machine for each application.
Yeah. Okay, but
we have our own fab, so we can just build
a
wafer.
But you will not necessarily change the materials also.
We don't want to change the materials. We may want to change the functional units, the rotation factories. We may want to change the connectivity between the qubits. Mm-hmm. We may want to change, so that we may want to change. But then we can also maybe do much of that in software, where like the FPGA that we reprogram. Since the expensive part here is not the functional unit, the expensive part is the memory. So you can just replicate the gates on every single bit in the memory.
Okay.
So the main thing that we have to change in the end is probably the connectivity.
Okay. Good. So If there are no more questions, I think I call this session to a close. Let's thank Matthias again.